Hey, everyone there. Thank you for spending a few minutes out of your day today to join Daniel and myself for a quick webinar. We're really excited to share some things with you and you know, things that have really helped practices, especially in the last 6 months during what we found the new normal to be since the COVID pandemic hit. So we're really excited to spend a few minutes with you today. It's not going to be a crazy long webinar. I'm sure you're not too upset about that. But again, we are excited to share some things with you. Kind of the format of this, Daniel and I are going to just, you know, ask each other some questions about some of the trends that we're seeing and improvements that practices can make that are going to benefit them both in the short term and in the long term. So by way of introduction, let me push over to here. We're going to be talking about kind of some virtual meeting tips, as well as how to get the most out of the modern patient journey. As far as who's on the phone, myself, Bryce Forbush, I work with a company called Podium. We've been around for 6 years, worked with thousands of practices in the space, trying to provide a better experience for patients and for practices. And then I've got Daniel Kivitinos, sorry, that's a tough name for me there, Daniel. But anyway, we've got Daniel. He is a co-founder and COO over at DrChrono. DrChrono has done some amazing things since being around in 2009 in the electronic health record space. Daniel, I'd love you to give just a quick intro to DrChrono, if you don't mind.
Sure. Can you guys hear me okay? Yes?
I can hear you there.
Perfect. Oh, perfect. Okay. Great. Yeah. So I'm a chief operating officer, co-founder of DrChrono. DrChrono is a medical records platform for physicians. So physicians and think of it as the operating system to run a whole entire practice. So physicians can prescribe medications, they can do medical charting, they could submit those medical charts to insurance companies for reimbursement when they see patients. We do scheduling, so it's a full platform.
Okay, awesome. And you know, I've been at Podium for 5 of the 6 years. Podium has over 800 employees now. I'm actually employee number 7. And so, Daniel, I can really appreciate kind of you being a co-founder there and everything that you've put into this. I know. There's so much that people don't see, and to build an amazing product like you've done, my hat goes off to you there. That's no easy task. But anyway, Daniel, I would love to just kind of start this off by asking you a question. So, on the topic of modernizing local practices, what are some steps that you see physicians taking to modernize their medical practice, and especially since COVID? What impact do you see e-health having on these practices?
Sure. So COVID has been kind of a game changer for everybody, where we all have essentially overnight we've all seen the world change. So it's really been a driver in new innovation. So some things that have been kind of laggers in the healthcare space, like telehealth, have really, risen as patients and providers are looking to technology to really kind of keep those encounters going. But what's interesting about this whole the whole pandemic is, prior to COVID, providers were seeing all of their patients essentially in person, and there was not that much telehealth happening. So instantaneously, I would say there's an exponential plethora of telehealth visits happening out there. And there's a lot of players out there that are really driving this type of change. One of them that I kind of look at is Medicare and Medicaid and the government. They are essentially paying now for telehealth visits. And the GDP of the healthcare in the United States is roughly, give or take, $3 trillion in healthcare spend.
That's all? I'm just kidding. That's, yeah.
Trillion. Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah.
it's a massive spend. And the United States spends a lot on healthcare. So when they start to reimburse providers for that care virtually, it's a game changer. And if you think about it, I personally have spoken to providers who have gotten COVID. I've spoken to patients who have gotten COVID. And what if you have a provider and they're seeing patients and they happen to get COVID, how do they keep working if they feel okay? They can do that virtually, right? You can see a patient virtually and you're not going to infect them, but it's vice versa. If a patient thinks they have COVID, they can see a provider virtually and also protect the provider and their staff and all the other patients that are coming in for that provider. So it's really a unique time where technology is being tested in healthcare way more than it ever has been.
Yeah. Yeah. We've seen that over here at Podium as well. And just like myself personally, not even like related to healthcare though, like you just look at all the changes that are happening across all industries, how businesses are adapting. Like you think about any local restaurant, maybe your favorite place, how many of those folks are now just, delivering their food or doing, pickup orders. Like it'd be interesting to see like your favorite restaurant, right? The percentage of takeout orders that they did before March versus now what percentage of their orders are that. And honestly, for me, like it's nice going out to dinner to eat or whatever, but also it's nice just going and picking up food and taking it home, right? Eating it on your couch and watching a game. And I think just these habits that consumers are in today or that they're, the habits that they're starting to form today, they translate in every industry. And so practices that are adapting to this and like you said, with the reimbursement that is happening for telehealth, yeah, like you have to be doing this. Have you seen a lot of pushback from physicians? Like I know you offer telehealth with your offering there. Danny, have you seen a lot of pushback from physicians and your customers like, oh, I don't want to do telehealth?
I think it's a mental shift. It's kind of when – think about like when banks went online, right? People were using paper money, physical money. You know, they had it in their wallet. They kept it under their bed. They put it in their bank. They would never think about logging on to a website and paying digitally for an item. That was kind of unheard of. I think there's a lot of this mental type of shift happening in healthcare today where a provider, a lot of them don't even realize they can get paid for a telehealth visit yet. They don't realize that they can see a patient virtually, like we're talking, via the web right now. They don't know that 15-minute encounter with the patient actually can get them paid from an insurance company. So a lot of it is an educational there's going to be a lot of education that's going to happen this year and next year and over the next several years. But I think that is a barrier. And patients, right? Like a lot of patients don't realize that they can possibly see like a therapist, a psychiatrist, their general practitioner virtually and say, hey, I need a prescription, whatever it is, like penicillin, right? I have providers can really do a lot virtually. And I think we're just beginning to see what that's going to look like. So the answer is yes, there is a lot of, I would say, lack of education, but also you're going to see a lot of education happening where providers are going to go, oh, I can actually do this through the web. I could do that through the web. I can actually do this through the web. So as this journey through COVID happens, providers are kind of enabling themselves through education and through tech to do more without having the physical patient come in. And I kind of think about like the old days when like they had the banks. They literally, you would drive to your bank and you would go to, a person and you would say, I'd like to take out $300. And then they would physically give you the money. And then you would go drive to a store and physically give them the paper money. And that was the way that we transacted for years. And when the banking system went online, it was really a mind shift for everybody in all of the United States where they're like, I don't trust it. I don't really understand it. How does it work? you know, it's kind of this whole education. And then over time, people started to really understand this does work. This is more efficient. My life is better. I think we're going through a lot of that today. And there's also this revolution around the technology. I mean, there's so much happening in the technology side. You know, I could go into different verticals of like virtual care. There's a lot. You know, that's another area where it's kind of like digital payments, right? Like Apple Pay is out there. You can use Apple Pay and you don't have to touch anything in a physical store, right? So like that whole world is changing. The same is sort of happening in the healthcare space today, where you can really do a lot in a new type of setting and experience.
Yeah.
So
I had a random thought just when you were talking about going to the bank and taking out money and then going to a store and then giving them that money. You know, imagine, I mean, COVID has had like a huge negative impact on the economy, right? Like it's been terrible. But imagine the impact that would have had if people were still transacting via cash, right? Like, oh, hey, I've touched all this money. Here you go. Like nobody would have been circulating money into the economy just because like, hey, like I'm going to get COVID, right? Just an interesting thought there. just as I'm thinking about, you know, what, aside from telehealth, I'm thinking like what other adjustments practices can make, to their practice to like help keep up with the times. You know, are you seeing any other trends out there?
Yeah, I think, you know, going back to Podium and what you guys are doing, I think going online and becoming more of a digital practice, the old brick and mortar physician is going to have to change, right? And I think this ties into a question for you, but, you know, you would generally drive past your general practitioner, your primary care physician, and say, oh, they're right down the block. I should go to them. That's really the way that like the world has been transacting. I guess a question for you and the Podium team is, how in this digital world does a provider find new patients? Like, how would that happen? Kind of just turning it back to you, what would you say would be a, you know, in this new world where, you know, post-COVID, what is a Podium and how does it help the providers like get new patients instead of the patients just walking into brick and mortar stores?
Yeah, it's interesting to think like 30 years ago, if your practice was located on some little side street, chances are you're going to fail, right? And nowadays, if you're not found online, you are going to fail, because that's where people are looking. But like, kind of going to the like, how do you find patients? There's a million ways to find patients, and that's a good thing and a bad thing. Because I'm sure, you know, anyone listening has, you know, spent money on marketing and thought, oh my gosh, I wasted $5,000 on this or on that, right? So there's a million ways that you can, you know, attract new patients. You can go pay for Google AdWords, you can pay for Facebook ads, you can pay for a billboard. I think with any initiatives that you're putting forth, you want to just track those as best possible. To really try and find something that works and replicate that over and over and over. And that's going to help you do really, really well. But like going kind of a step back, how are you even found online though, right? If you think about like, here's a quick tip. If you're not subscribed to Think with Google, I am, and they'll send emails all the time of just like trends that are happening within search. I would subscribe to that so that you can get those tips. But something that I read a while back is 76% of near me searches result in a and see what they have online and try and mimic what they have to some degree. And just make sure that you have your very best foot forward and you look like an amazing choice in that local market.
Got it. Okay. That's a really great tip. I feel like a lot of providers don't know how to market themselves. They don't know how to find new patients. So would they use is that what Podium does for them, would you say? Or is that they would hire like an SCM, SEO expert or a firm?
Yeah. I mean, you can do a combination of the two. Our customers, they have really high success in just gaining organic traffic by maximizing things like their Google My Business page. For example, like online reviews, that's a huge part of what Podium does. And honestly, there's, you know, probably 300 companies that will help to some degree with online reviews, but you have to make that as simple as possible. Like anyone on this call, they can think back to a time where they mustered up the courage to ask for an online review and then nobody left a review. And then they're like, well, that was dumb. I was vulnerable. I asked for a review. I didn't want to ask for a review, but I did. And then it didn't result in anything, but they have to, you know, you have to keep the consumer in mind too. And the experiences that they're used to, if it's not easy for them to do, they just aren't going to do that at all. So, hold on. I have a neighbor boy that just walked into my room. Hold on just a second. Hey, yes, you can have a popsicle, but you need to go outside. I'm sorry, Daniel and anyone else. Oh my gosh. Now the no neighbor's in here. You're right. Sorry. Here we go. Let's get out of here. Come on. Let's go outside.
So just going off his Bryce's thought on reviews, I do think that reviews are critical for online presence. As the world goes virtual, I was just kind of riffing on some thoughts, but just what you were saying about reviews, you know, as the world goes virtual, that's going to become more more important, right? Because you don't know the provider. You don't know who you're going to. You may want to learn about the provider, more about what their history is, who they see. And if it's a virtual visit, how do you know who you're seeing? You know, how do you know what their experience is like? So I guess doing the research as a patient for yourself, for your family, you know, it definitely gives you more insight into the provider. Now, when there are newer providers that don't have any reviews, I mean, that's interesting because you just don't know, right? You just kind of are going to a provider and you just really don't know. But then there's providers out there that have a lot of reviews. You feel this confidence going in to see that provider. You feel like, okay, there's 200 reviews. This provider is clearly taking care of most of their patients. The patients are really happy. That creates an instant inflow of patients, which is phenomenal. But I guess like when you have no reviews, how do you, or if you have negative reviews, how do you even get those reviews, right? Like, I guess that's a question. Do they just ask? Do they put up, you know,
yeah,
text me at Podium? And
yeah, you're exactly right. And like, you know, that confidence that those reviews give people, it's really interesting to see like the transformation that consumers have had. Just like, I'm not going to go get a babysitter and go watch a movie that has poor reviews, right? So, you know, if I'm using that to decide what movie I watched, you know, how much more important reviews to a, you know, choosing a family physician or, you know, a dermatologist or anything, right? But yeah, like how do you even get those reviews? I've seen everything in the book at this point as far as like strategies to get those reviews. People are calling the patient a couple days later. People are emailing, people are like spending much money making these nice little cards to hand out. at checkout. And all those things can work. But like, how effective do you want to be with that? And I would start first with like setting a goal as to, hey, how many reviews do I want to have? And like, what impact will that have? And then with something like Podium, we're backed by Google Ventures. So we have some technology that just makes this process as simple as possible. So, you know, with Podium, they receive a text message, they click on the link, and boom, they're leaving a review to Google, to Facebook, to Health Grades, whatever might be important for you at that time. And so just in building that reputation, if you have a bad one right now, get that fixed. Also read those reviews. I imagine most of those reviews are just from crazy people saying, hey, like the door was stuck, right? Just something like not even related to their care. But yeah, like, you know, read those reviews, try and fix processes within your practice. But then, yeah, set a goal and you know, use a system that's going to help get you to that goal. You know, again, you can get there on your own, but how much money do you put on your time, right? Like, how valuable is your time? And, you know, something like Podium can help you get it done really, really quickly.
I think because patients are also becoming more educated on what a review means to a provider. If the patient is giving that provider a new review, it's kind of saying thank you for the like taking care of me or my family also. So it does help the provider. And I think patients, as they get more educated on online reviews, they're going to become more active for sure. Like, you know, I think COVID has changed a lot digitally, but reviews are really kind of still, they're kind of a newer thing, right? Like, when did reviews really come out? Like, early 2000s, honestly. Like, it really hasn't been around that long. Amazon, right? Like, you have Amazon reviewing, you know, items, products, like physical devices and books and those sorts of things. But I think it's kind of a, you know, it's not 100-year-old idea, right? It's kind of a new thing where patients can really honestly support their providers. And I think that's also, it keeps the providers aware, you know, these patients are savvy. They found me online. They know, you know, they're going to give me a possible review. So I want to make sure I give them the best care possible. So it's kind of a win-win all around. If you have that cycle, you know, patient finds you, new patient, they come in from an online source.
Yeah,
patient's going to be aware that they can go back to that site, like Google reviews, and put a review there.
Yeah, and something interesting too. And if you don't watch this, viewers, look at your Google My Business data. It'll show you a lot about what's happening online. There's four really, really important categories that we at Podium like to track for our customers, and that's the increase in your website visits, the increase in clicks to call, driving directions, and there's one more I'm spacing it right now, but there's four really important ones. Those three are really, really vital to kind of tracking the performance of your business. But as folks increase their online reviews, they see significant increases in all of those areas. And so just the impact that you know, online reviews have in making your practice visible online is huge. So it, you know, far outweighs any investment you put into, you know, improving your reputation there. Daniel, I had a thought just a second ago as you were talking. I know you guys offer like a lot of online scheduling. Is that right? Through DrChrono, right? What impact have you seen providing online scheduling for your clients? Like, what impact does that have for the day-to-day of the practice?
It really depends on the practice. So if you have a established urgent care, and the urgent care has been there 30 years, online bookings may not be that relevant because it's a physical brick and mortar store that's just been around, and they have their existing client base, and the client base knows if they get a laceration, they can drive down the block immediately and go to that urgent care because it's been there and it'll always be there. But if you are a new and up and coming urgent care that is 1 month old, how do you get that online patient booking going? And that's where it becomes way more critical. And every practice is different. So it really depends on the needs. So even that 30-year-old practice might fall into this category, but online booking is something that is becoming the norm. You know, picking up the phone, that's great, but not everybody wants to do that anymore, right? It's more convenient. Say you have to go into a physical job and you don't want to get on the phone and say, I need to go to the doctor. It's kind of an embarrassing thing for a patient. They can simply just, you know, we have tools for it. We have like an API that exposes all of the appointments and exposes like what's available that can be booked. So we have a lot of partners that can like block times on DrChrono and schedule for the provider using some app. But we also have like a widget that they can put on their site. So we have an online scheduling widget that allows the provider to launch their own website, you know, drsmith.com or whatever their domain is. They put all their content up there. They put up, you know, what they do. They can also put up a section and put it, it's called an iframe. You can place an iframe inside of the website that basically shows all of the appointments. Now they can use our API and they can hire a developer and they can also do it that way. So they have, you know, whatever experience they want, but there's a lot of ways to do it. I guess it does come down to what, at the end of the day, patients are going to go to providers who give the patient the best experience possible. Meaning, you want to book it when you want to book it, when you want to book it. Like, meaning I can book at 3 a.m., I'm not feeling well. I wake up, I open my iPhone or my Android and I tap, 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 and I'm booked. You don't have to call somebody at 2 p.m., you know, that your time zone and hope you get them on the phone. So I think it's as time goes on, the phone is going to become less relevant, but online bookings are going to become the norm. Like when you book an airline, I mean, airlines right now, it's a horrible time for airlines, but a lot of the time people just go online and book it because it's way more convenient than calling somebody and saying, how much did these 7 flights cost and what time? And you kind of just get this really quick information chart of it all. And it says, this is the price, this is the time, this is what I'm getting. And you kind of can do that in healthcare also. And I think it's going to become like the airline industry, like for booking, it's going to become like, you know, hotel industry for booking. And it's just going to become the norm. Now, a lot of providers don't do it because they're not, they don't have the time. They're like, a lot of it is like time restrictions. They have to see 30 patients in a day. You know, they have 15-minute increments with those 30 patients. They have to get in at like 7 a.m. They're seeing sick people. It's important for the provider to educate themselves on technology because it does help them long term. They don't have to hire a staff member to man the phones. Yeah. Right. If they actually find, it doesn't have to be DrChrono. It could be whatever they feel like is the right booking tool. It could be whatever they feel is like, okay, this tool is working for me and I don't need 3 staff members to man the phones. I only need 1. And, you know, I get whatever it is, 5 bookings a day, like filled in. That's amazing. There are more sophisticated tools like, you know, one partner of DrChrono said 25% of appointments booked from patients get canceled. How do you fill those? If you have those online appointments enabled, you don't have to like sporadically, you know, call patients and be like, hey, you know, John, you know, or a patient canceled today at 3 p.m. Can you come in? Right. With online booking, it kind of just opens up for the patient and they can book it, which is amazing. I mean, it's just the way that things should be. And I think things are changing. I think everything is going online. And I think the experience for the providers are going to be really, it's going to be very different over the next 10 years. And we're going to expect more as patients. And if providers are not looking for those tools, they're going to lose out. Like it's honestly, there is a competition happening, right? Like how many patients can I book? And I want to give them the best experience possible. But if you're spending time hiring, like, you know, a lot of staff members to do a lot of manual work without technology, it just gets expensive.
Yeah. Expensive, and it's just not a good experience for the physician, or is it a good experience for the people that he or she hired, right? To do those manual tasks. I have a chiropractor in a town just close to the town that I live in, and it's about, you know, 7 miles away. And when COVID hit, like all this work from home stuff, my back was just killing me. And I called in to schedule an appointment because they didn't have anything on their website. I really liked his chiropractor and I needed to go in. And I called in like 4 times one day and I couldn't get anyone on the phone. And they're busy handling phone calls and scheduling and things like that. But if they would have just had a way for me to, like, you know, send a message or just book, like at that point I was ready to book. I didn't have any questions. I was just ready to book, right? And so you mentioned a few minutes ago, Daniel, hey, it's just so important that you provide the very best experience possible. And I think if we could take anything from this webinar, it's how do we just provide the very best experience for our patients, but while not diminishing like the work that my team has to do in-house, right? Like, how do we get found online? Okay, go online and see what people are seeing about you, and you can easily see what can be improved, okay? Go to your website and see, okay, can somebody book with me very easily? Or how are they even contacting me? You mentioned, hey, I just want to be able to wake up, boom, 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 and get scheduled, right? Nobody wants to pick up, few people want to pick up the phone and call. They typically just have like maybe one or two basic questions if it's for a new provider. They want to ask those, do you accept the insurance? Do you have availability? Blah, blah, blah. And that's it. So, you know, a little plug for Podium and DrChrono. Podium, we offer something that if somebody gets to your website, again, they went through that journey of like doing their research. Now they found you. They're on your website. Maybe it is after hours. Maybe they don't want to pick up the phone and call. Podium has an option so folks can text in from the website. Hey, have a question, text us here. They send a text and now they can put their search on hold and they're communicating with you via text message. Now they've answered the questions. Great, the practice sends a text back. Hey, just go pick a time that works through our scheduling app or scheduling widget, right? So yeah, just the experiences that consumers are used to today, Daniel, like it's crazy to just see across the board, whether it's healthcare, automotive, home services, really anywhere you look, the experiences that consumers have in their day to day, that's what they expect with their healthcare as well. And, you know, a system like DrChrono and Podium, like that's why we've been so successful, is we have provided practices with the technology that makes their lives easier and helps them get found easier. So it's been a big win. And Daniel, I can't speak for you, but it's been so fun for me to be with Podium from the get-go and see the transformation that practices have taken, utilizing technology to their benefit. We've preached, you know, that these things are important for so long, and now COVID hits and now businesses are realizing more than ever that these things are important. So it's kind of been forcing the hand a little bit there, but yeah, Daniel, do you have any, you know, input there as far as what you're seeing with the practices today? And I can't hear you anymore. I cannot hear you. I don't know. Do not know what happened there. Can you hear me? Yeah. Dang it, Daniel, I cannot hear you. Maybe try refreshing your browser there, Daniel.
Can you hear me now?
Oh, there it is. Good to hear your voice again.
Awesome. Sorry about that. I think one thing that you brought up that I think is really interesting was you mentioned briefly texting, and I think that's a really powerful tool that a lot of providers can take advantage of. And I guess, what does Podium offer there? Because as a patient, I love it when I can text my provider and interact through a text, or even the staff. It really creates a lift of engagement where I feel connected to the practice, and everyone is texting. The world is kind of texting, you know, back and forth all of the time now. What does Podium offer in terms of texting, you know, on the patient and doctor end?
Yeah, that's a really great question. A lot of folks have been slow to adopt texting because they're scared of it. One, there's a lot of like liability with texting with their patients, with HIPAA laws and all that jazz. But secondly, they just haven't had like an easy way of doing it. A lot of folks have purchased a cell phone and they've just dedicated that cell phone to be able to text. Virtually everyone is sending like an appointment reminder, which is, that's great. Like, people want to be reminded via text. They don't really want a phone call. But like having a two-way texting platform is so critical to be able to manage any of these communications. So kind of high level, Podium, everything that we do is built around this text messaging engine. We've got this engine and it can help you do really just about anything within the practice. We kind of have a slogan that says, should it be a text? And there's so many scenarios where a practice administrator may be picking up the phone and calling somebody to ask them a question, or you know, they're receiving all these phone calls. So I guess Podium, what we do is we provide texting in basically every scenario. If a new patient wants to text in from the website, they can. If somebody wants to message in from Facebook, those messages pull into Podium. The review invitations, they all go out via text message. Any of the responses to the messages, they funnel into this one centralized inbox so that practice can have one place to communicate with their patients. Something really popular that they've done is with their reminders, they have said, hey, I know you don't want to wait in the waiting room right now, so text us when you get here and we'll send you a text back and we're ready to have you come back. Right. And so just utilizing text messaging really as much as possible is saving so much time for these practices and just helping them be so much more efficient. And these practice administrators, they love their jobs more so than they did before, just because of all the phone tag that they're cutting out on. So that was a very long-winded answer. Hopefully that helps.
No, that actually, even with that cancellation problem, if 25% of appointments are canceled, if the patient can text you back and say, I can't make it, as fast as possible, it allows the staff to like be proactive in booking time, because time is money for the provider. They come into work, you know, if their appointment book is full, it's honestly a great day because they're using their time efficiently. They're helping as many patients that want to see that provider. So I do think that text messaging is something that every provider should look into. And I think that they should definitely figure out how to do it, at least with just booking appointments, right? How do I book appointments through text efficiently with my staff? Ask yourself that question and say, what do I do to text patients? Hey, you're coming in 24 hours. Just want to confirm that you're coming. You know, if the patient says, I can't make it, an emergency happened, that's fine. It's just, at least the provider is aware now, you know, it's so much less efficient to have a staff member call the patient, leave a message on their voicemail, right? It should be kind of, you know, we're all texting in the world today. So I actually think that's part of like a big change that's happening. The providers who text, I really kind of put them on a pedestal as a patient. I'm like, okay, these people are texting me. It's their staff. Their staff are texting me saying, hey, you have this appointment, it's coming up. That little bit of interaction keeps me engaged, makes me feel like they're kind of looking at the forefront of tech a little bit more. And the staff are kind of on top of it, looking at all their patients that are coming in, you know, prior to the patient coming in.
Yeah, but, and if 25% of those are canceled, like how easy is it for that person that did cancel to think, you know, I actually, you know, a couple days later, they're like, okay, I need to get in. Let me just send them a quick text. So, yeah. People have got to adapt. People are adapting, and you know, businesses have to adapt. Otherwise, it's going to be tough sledding. Daniel, we have been doing this for 40 minutes. It's gone by pretty fast for me. I don't have really any other questions for you. If you don't have any for me, maybe we could just open it up to some questions for the audience, and yeah, we could try and answer those for these folks.
Sure. Yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah.
So we could open it up.
Yeah, if we could do that.
I think one thing as we wait for questions to come in, one thing that I didn't really mention was remote patient monitoring. I think that's something that's going to be a really interesting part of the digital healthcare revolution. They call it RPM. And, you know, we'll wait till some questions come in, but RPM is something that I feel like is really, over the next 10 years, you're going to see some interesting stuff. And what is RPM? So say you find your doctor online, say you're texting with your doctor online, say you have televisits with your doctor online. There's also something called RPM where the provider can ask the patient to get, say, a glucose meter, and that will be uploaded. That data can be uploaded to the cloud. They can ask them to get a blood pressure cuff. That could be uploaded to the cloud. They can have a scale. That could be uploaded to the cloud. There's a lot of different devices now that the provider can remotely monitor patients with. And it allows the provider to even do more without the patient having to come in. And an example is you have a homebound patient, meaning they can't leave their home. It's an enormous task to get that patient to the doctor's office, right?
Yeah.
So,
and remote, you know, I think with that, just like, I think that increases patient outcomes. Right? Like how much better is it for that patient to not have to leave their house, that they can be monitored, you know, remotely, and, you know, their care and their outcome, maybe the speed of that outcome is increased significantly. So that's really cool to think about. I'd love to get in a rabbit hole about just that sometime with you, Daniel. I think that's a fascinating topic there. We do have one question here. It says, how do we define virtual care? Sometimes it gets lumped into telehealth, but virtual care is really telehealth, remote patient monitoring and digital health. Yeah, that's a good question. How do we define virtual care? I would just say it's care that's happening outside of the office. I don't know. Do you have any thoughts there, Daniel?
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. It's like care that's not happening. It's happening online. So virtual care can be anything. I mean, honestly, like when I think of telehealth more means to me like telemedicine. Telemedicine means that there is a provider maybe prescribing a drug. Virtual care can be anything. Maybe it's just someone saying, have you taken your prescriptions? Maybe it's not even the doctor. That's virtual care, right? It could be a staff member saying, hey, we're just doing our, you know, daily checkup. Did you take that medication that you need to be taking daily? That's not the provider doing care, but that's a virtual, right? That's just virtual health.
Yeah, and what is that doing for the patient? They're thinking, oh my gosh, yeah, that's, thank you for checking. I do need to do this, right? So they received care that day. And it's probably not even billed, right? And doesn't have to be, but they receive the care to increase their outcome, right? So that's a good question. And Daniel, I love that response. There is one more question here. I'll read that, and then maybe we'll wrap up if there's no more. This one says, as I build out my digital presence, where do you both see the perfect moment for human interaction so my patients feel like a person, not just another visit? Perfect moment. That's a tough one. I don't think there is any sort of perfect moment, but I think you have a great point there in that, like, people want to feel like they are cared for. So I think, yeah, this is a not like so straightforward answer. If you don't mind, I'm just going to read through that again, just to, you know, try and provide the best answer for you there. I think catering to their needs. Each patient is different. So some folks aren't going to do telehealth and they need to be seen by you, and they need to be, you know, feel like that you hear them and see them. So for that person, you want to cater to them, and you know, technology probably isn't going to be the biggest thing for them. But then there are folks that, you know, maybe they need more appointments, but you know, maybe you don't have to spend as much time with them, and offering telehealth for that patient so that they can do a virtual consult maybe more regularly, they are going to feel much better about the care that they're receiving. There's so many different types of people out there, and in such, there's just so many different types of patients. And so I think, you know, having the technology in place to help cater to you know, those that need that, that's going to be great. But also, you know, having the availability for others that require different care is huge. So there's no real perfect moment. I think just catering to the needs of each individual are really important.
Yeah, and I can jump in there. I think there's like moments of wow that can happen, meaning like, you ever get a PDF in an email and you had to like print it and write on the piece of paper? A moment of wow is like prior to the appointment, what data needs to be captured and how. Like a moment of wow is like, say you have like an app like Uber, they capture your credit card and you don't have to type it in and it goes magically into your phone even before you have to, like, you get a car from Uber. That's a moment of wow where it's pre-appointment almost. So if you can capture information about the patient as painless as possible prior to the appointment, that's a moment of wow. I think there's also like in the waiting room. So say there's like a virtual waiting room or you go to the physical waiting room. A moment of wow is like what is around them. Like maybe there's a screen on the wall and it says there's 5 minutes to the next patient. It's the little things like that. You know, you see that on the wall and you're like, wow, that I'm going to be seen in 5 minutes. And then you believe them. And then you go in and you see the provider. And then when you're seeing the provider, when the provider is engaged with the patient at a really high level, asking questions and not just furiously typing on a computer to document, that's another moment of connection. It's really a time for the provider to really let the patient know that they're there for them. And, you know, when the patient leaves, engagement, like how do you know, engage with the patient? The patient may go, oh my God, that was a great experience, leave, and then the provider never follows up. Like just even to say, hey, you know, it's been 6 months, how are you doing? It could be anything. It could be a marketing email. It could be anything to like just keep that patient realizing that the provider is there for them. So there's always like different areas and there's different tools for all of this. But I think it's really like curating that experience for yourself as a provider, you can really differentiate yourself out there, because a lot of, you know, a lot of providers are, you know, they're doing their job. It's a tough job, but there's these little things that you really can like put in place that really, they really just like can wow a patient, right? Like patient education, maybe, you know, drawing on an iPad, you know what I mean? Like as a provider in the room with the patient, and the patient's like, okay, I understand what you're saying, because there's a lot of information that has to be absorbed. Pamphlets are great. Patients lose pamphlets. If the patient leaves the office and it's like digitally texted to them or like placed into like their medical record and the patient can get access after the appointment, that's another like moment where you go, wow, this is, there's something to this provider. They really get like the experience for me.
Yeah. There's a book called Atomic Habits that I have no affiliate link to, you know, get paid for sponsoring this book. But it talks about incremental improvements to yourself, to your business, et cetera. And it's typically not about the big changes that you make. It's about the little 1% improvements that you make for yourself, for your business, et cetera, that are going to have the biggest impact on you and your business. So, you know, little things go a long ways. And technology is there to make it easier, and it does make it easier. So don't be afraid of technology, because, you know, there's some really great people building some really great things that are going to make you, you know, a lot more money and make your life easier and provide better care. Looks like there's one more question. We'll answer that one a lot quicker than we answered the last one. And then we'll let you guys get out of here. This one says, with some staff working remotely and some in office, does Podium and or DrChrono make team communication easy? Podium does make that easy as well. Like, we have our texting engine, our messaging engine, an inbox there, but then we also have an inbox for a team so that you can communicate across your teams as well. Been really, really nice since COVID, actually. So, yeah. Do you offer anything like that, Daniel?
Yeah, so I think it's just having the ability to view all the information about a patient on your iPhone or your iPad or the web. It's needed when you need it. And I think when you're in having those interactions with other staff members, what was prescribed to that patient? They can open their phone and immediately start to see that information very quickly, or whatever device they're on. But it's available in the cloud anywhere. In a simple way. So, you know, it allows for that dialogue and that communication.
That's huge. Think about how many times somebody, you know, receives a request when they're working remotely and they're not by their laptop, right? And they're out, you know, picking their kid up from school or something, right? And, you know, they can easily access that information through DrChrono, and then, you know, through Podium, they could communicate that information, you know, across the team. There's even like different channels that you can create for like a new patient channel or a billing channel or, you know, et cetera. So you can ask a question there, and then you're just managing these communications from your iPhone within the app. So, yeah. Great. Well, there are no other questions there. Daniel, thank you so much for, you know, spending a few minutes with me today. It was really nice to, you know, this is the first time I've met Daniel. So it was fun having you on today. It felt like a podcast. So maybe we'll be celebrity podcasters sometime. Probably not. But yeah, thank you so much for spending some time with me today.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much. And this was great.
Yeah. And then, you know, if anyone has any questions after this,